Hello friends, this is micro videos on international relations from the interview point of view. This is a burning topic. Very recently, the second forum of BRI, Belt and Road Initiative, has concluded, and we had found 76 cities had participated. All of a sudden, Europe had started showing interest. Even UK had sent its diplomats. And the USA was not happy with this. But there are, you can see the doubts on China about the BRI. So what are those doubts? Where we find it's having some sort of confusion? Why the vision, what China is able to see, rest of the world is not able to anticipate. They are not able to visualize. What's wrong with the economic diplomacy of China on BRI? That's what we have to discuss. So one thing we have to keep in mind, that this BRI is basically connecting Africa, Asia and Europe. And the Pacific realm, the islands, the 16 island groups major of the Pacific Ocean. Very recently, the second forum had concluded, 76 nations have participated into it. And this is BRI is also, you know, considered a bliss. Why? Because it is accommodating the demographic dividend of the world. Not of China or India or Southeast Asia, we are talking about the demographic dividend of the world. The world's population has recently increased. It was you can say 5 billion on 11th of July 1987, 6 billion 1999, 2011 we had found this is 7 billion. This is nearly 7.5 billion right now. There is a huge, you can say, the population in between 15 and 64 years of age. The working hands, they are in need of meaningful engagement, and China, through its $1 billion projects, it's giving the right kind of, you can say, environment for the demographic dividend of the world that is having right now. One thing we have to keep in mind, the entire Pacific Ocean and the Indian Ocean, the Atlantic Ocean, they are under the surveillance of USA and the Western Alliance. They are having plenty of islands. They keep on monitoring each and every part of the oceans. And China and Russia into the eastern parts, they feel very much, you know, strangulated, stifled, suffocated, when every moment is monitored. USA is there in Japan, in Okinawa Islands. USA is there below the 38th parallel, that is in South Korea, with its THAAD, the missile system. USA is there into Taiwan. USA is in Guam Islands. USA is there into the Micronesia. USA is there very near the Hawaiian Islands. USA is almost everywhere into the 16 countries of the Pacific Island Forum. USA is in Singapore. It's not only the India that is giving the Malacca dilemma to China, it's USA also. China had already seen in 1971 and 1999, when we were having confrontation with Pakistan, that somewhere we were having our iron curtains across the passages, the transit passages of South and Southeast Asia. China knows this thing, that they are under great surveillance, and they just want to connect the Pacific Ocean and the Indian Ocean. And they just want to extend the connectivities to the Atlantic Ocean through the land corridors. So somewhere we will find, when there are the alternate routes, then lots of interport trade centers like Singapore, they are going to suffer from lack of business. It's a straightway challenge to the trade routes dominated by and set by the USA and US allies. Now, the very first thing, the very first doubt that gives, you can say, a bad economic diplomacy is their Belt and Road Initiative is seen an effort to enhance the sphere of influence. Development of transport infrastructure has dual use for the commercial purposes and for the military purposes. It is an attempt to export a political model of China. This is our first doubt the world is having, and where, though they are spending a lot, they are having the dollar diplomacy, but it's not working that way. The second one, There is no official listing of the projects. The number is increased or decreased in accordance to the political milieu. A country that is cooperative, they're going to have 2, 3, 4, 5 projects. If the country is not cooperative, they are not opting for. Moreover, the project is going to be short time duration, long time duration. So that is also not, you can say, well mentioned. That is, you can say, the third doubt. Each international project has a specified duration. There are least references about the long term and the short term projects. China itself is not sure. The projects that they are developing into the countries, what will be their future? Somewhere they themselves have the doubts. Because every country is having a political regime, and the development of the projects is subjected to the political environment of that country. We will see the example, what had happened there in Malaysia, right? And how with the change of the Prime Minister, things have changed so quickly. Fourth one, the projects are financed in multiple ways. Exim Bank, Export-Import Bank of China, China Development Bank, Industrial and Commercial Bank of China, Bank of China, Asian Infrastructure and Investment Bank. Terms and conditions are not same for all the participating countries. There are multiple financial institutions which are rolling into the entire system. Right? Projects are being developed by these financial institutions. Right? And these financial institutions are also giving the loans for the projects which are not the part of the BRI also there. So somewhere we find there's a multiplicity of the financial institutions, a kind of quagmire that has developed. A kind of, you know, the marshy, the sticky, you can say, situation has developed there. The fifth one, 76 BRI member nations have received only 25% of the total investments, Chinese investments. When you say that this is meant for the entire world, then why the 75% of the investments are there only in China? So this is, you can say, a little bit of doubt, or they themselves are skeptic. And then China makes its own people move. They outsource their people. Wherever the project goes on, right? These are the Chinese people. They are, you can say, managing each and everything. This is the least engagement of the local youth or the local workers. Moreover, there is a big cultural rift. And always we find that there are the duels which erupt between the Chinese and the local populations. BRI vision has seen 250 billion investment and pledges 1,000 billion US dollars investment. Grand design of BRI is not clear to all. China suggests 6 international corridors and 6 maritime routes. Though they keep on telling what exactly they have thought about, still we find that the member nations of the forum, the 76 countries, they are not adequately informed. Now we have seen a very worse example of Tajikistan. This is one of the 14 countries that shares international border with China. They were having a dispute. Lots of investment had taken place in Tajikistan. Right, all the investments which have turned out to be the bad investments for China, they were not able to pay, repay, and they have been waived off. But 1158 square kilometer of the area by Tajikistan has been forfeited, and they have sorted out their border dispute with China. Look, this kind of, we can say, issue when comes in front of the world, then the world turns out to be literally tight-lipped. Now, when the global media had asked, the world media had asked that what was the total debt that you have waived off for 1158 square kilometers area, then again, they are silent on this issue there. There's another bad example we're having. 1.12 billion US Sri Lankan port project of Hambantota. It's 85% equity. And 99% leased to China. This is a bad example, and it gives us an idea of the Chinese hidden motives. Now China, very near to India, into the Indian Ocean, they're at Hambantota, and you can say very near to Hambantota, the Colombo, the deep port. So it's a matter of concern for India, it's a matter of concern for USA, that's not very far away into Daegu Kasia. So when these kind of examples come in front of us, then we find this is a sheer example of, sheer you can say instance of economic, bad economic diplomacy, or this is economic imperialism. There's another example of Malaysia that is having 700 kilometers long project. The previous government of Najib Razak and the government of China, they had signed it. The total amount has been reduced to one third when the new government had come. Lots of corruption had taken place. The new Prime Minister Mahathir Mohamad, he had rectified it, renegotiated it, and the total amount of the infrastructure project has come down to one third. And one can understand that how much, inflated figures were put forward by both ends, Malaysia as well as China. So keeping this thing in mind, what China had done, that people may not understand what exactly had happened over there, they have reduced the length of the entire project from 700 kilometers to 660 kilometers. And the price had reduced to one third. So this is literally confusing, and it raises doubts that something is wrong there in the projects. Then China has started, you can say, confidence building measures. They have started evaluating very objectively the financial status of the country, whether they will be able to, you can say, pass on their debt or not, which way they have to manage the countries which are having, you can say, high chances of insolvency. So when they have started doing all these things objectively right now, what they have done in the last 5 years, since 2013 the project has been introduced, that really raises a doubt, and puts a huge sign of interrogation, that in the last 5 years, whatever the investments made by China, they are really in a trouble. And the last point which we have cited that goes against this, you know, the economic diplomacy, China does better job out to the environmental issues whenever the projects are there within the country. But the moment they are having the projects in some other country, then they are going to flay each and every, you can say, the condition to for the upkeep of the environment. They are flouting the sanctity of the environment, and the projects in the foreign lands, they do not, you can say, care for what will be the possible repercussions. So this is a case of the double standards of China. Now, if we have to see in entirety, both USA and Great Britain, they are having false propaganda against China. China always, you can say, puts forward this kind of thing. They say that these countries keep on, you can say, framing phrases and highlighting the geopolitical motives of China. They use their academic platform. They are having so many of the scholars involved in, you can say, scrutinizing each and everything done by China and highlighting where they have done things wrong. There are geopolitical motives. There are, you can say, the economic, you can say, the opportunism China seeks into BRI. But somewhere we must understand this is relevant for China, and this should be relevant for the rest of the world. This thing, they must make it, you can say, clear into the mind of the rest of the countries. Thank you.